Good morning. Good morning. It's nice to have all of you with us here this morning on this beautiful Sunday morning as we come to worship God and to start our week. It's good to have each one of you here today. Say good morning to our children. Glad to have them in worship as well. This morning we are very pleased to have our Crossroads singers as the lead musicians for our worship service today. And as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, they are going to lead us in our prelude.
Take me in your life, oh Lord, take me in your life, oh. It will stand the raging storm. Take me in your life, oh Lord, take me in your life, oh. It will bear my spirit home. Take me in your life, oh, oh, take me in your life, oh. It will stand the raging storm. Take me in your life, oh, oh, take me in your life, oh. It will bear my spirit home. The clouds are so heavy, the winds are so loud. The thunder is rolling, it's bursting in the clouds. Their shipmates for what they had done. They took the dying sinners in their life, oh. Take me in your life, boat, oh, take me in your life, boat. It will stand the raging storm. Take me in your life, boat, oh, take me in your life, boat. It will bear my spirit home. Jesus set sail on that Sea of Galilee with his disciples and went fishing on the sea. When the storm rose, the disciples shook with fear. They prayed, oh Jesus, take us in your life, oh. Take me in your life, oh, oh, take me in your life, oh.
Well, that got your toes to tapping, so let's stand and join me in the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and praise.
Give thanks to the Lord. Bless God's holy name.
For the Lord is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
If you'll remain standing to sing hymn number 384, but we are going to sing that to the tune of Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Jesus, Thou art all compassion.
Now will you remain standing and turn in your bulletins. Let us affirm our faith together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is created, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I'd like to invite the children to come down for our time together. Kids, come on. To do, so we're not going to have much time together. I need the glue sticks. We have to have the glue sticks later. I'm always need glue sticks. Where are the, here they are, glue sticks. Right, all right, so glue sticks. Okay, that one's good. This one's dry. This glue sticks, okay, good on the glue sticks. Ah, colored pencils, all right, we got the colored pencils. Let me see. Ah, they're not sharpened. You cannot do an activity without the sharpened colored pencils. Where, I need a pencil sharpener. Where is that? Excuse me. All right. Gotta have the pencil sharpened for the activity. Very important. Every one of them sharpened. Okay. Have to put them in a Roy G. Biv order later. All right. So pencils, glue sticks, pencils. Excuse me. Not right now. Okay. All right, got to make sure the two-way radios are working for safety. All right, let's check in. Can you hear me, Elizabeth? Come in, Elizabeth. Over.
Yeah, Mr. Mark, I can hear you loud and clear.
You forgot to say over, Elizabeth. Over.
Why do I have to say over?
Why do you have to say what?
I said, why do I have to say over?
Yeah, I hear you saying, why do you have to say, and then why do you have to say what?
Why do I have to say over, over?
You have to say over so that I'll know you're done talking with me. Over.
Oh, I've been done talking with you for a while now, Mr. Mark.
Okay, right. So the radios work. All right, what? All right, fine. It says, make time for me. I forget that a lot. Thank you. I get so carried away doing things for the people I care about that I forget to actually spend time with the people I care about. I treasure you more than I treasure the things that it takes to get ready for you being here. And I'm sorry to you and to all the people in my life who I ignore by doing the things getting ready for you instead of spending the time treasuring you. Is it okay if I do the prayer for us? I think I need a prayer really bad today. All right, can you be here? Is it okay if I pray? Maybe we can have the energy of my prayer? Okay. It's kind of selfish of me, I know, but I've been selfish all morning so far, so why should this be any different? Gracious God, thank you so much for the gift of these children. Thank you so much for the gift of every person in my life. Help me to treasure them so that my heart can be not in the stuff, but with the things in life that I truly treasure, the people and the places that absolutely matter to me, and I want to have be a part of my life for as long as I have breath. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Let's go spend some time together.
I couldn't help but notice that Mr. Mark seemed to be in a little bit of a lather at the beginning of the children's message, but gosh, I think he found the treasure that he was looking for and the treasure that all of us come to seek. So with that in mind, simply thank you for being here today. Thank you for being part of this worshiping community. For those of you who have been here for year after year after year, and those of you who are here for the first time today, we particularly want to welcome you. And it would be fun to know that you've been here. So if you haven't already, I encourage you to tear off the connection card from that side of the bulletin. And we would love for all of you, member, new resident, guest, all of you, we would love for you to fill out the upper part of the connection card, and if you would, please put that in the offering plate when that comes by in a moment. The lower part, along with the back of the bulletin, is a nice reminder of things coming up this week and even beyond that. For some of you, this may be the day that you'd like to become a member of our congregation, and we would be honored to welcome you. Nearby, you'll find a How to Join card. You can fill that out during the service, and then at the end of the service, Linda will give you an invitation so that during that hymn, Dr. Lamar Smith and Dr. Brewster would love to meet you here at the communion rail and introduce you to the congregation. Speaking of introductions, I am very pleased to introduce to you my friend, my colleague, and one of us. Mr. Roger Partridge, a member of our congregation and a member of our church staff, is our director of stewardship. And Roger has a good message for us today.
Good morning. Our first staff meeting in January, I was on the agenda to talk about our stewardship plans. And it was a last minute change on it because I had the dates and I had who was speaking and I knew the mailings and all of that. And I decided to follow our theme, this is why I give. So I told the staff why I give. And at the end of my talk, my few minutes, Tim said, Roger, I want you to share that with the congregation, maybe on the 24th. And Lamar Smith spoke up and said, and don't leave out the part about the pickup truck. So here we go. I was raised on a farm in rural Illinois. My dad was a farmer, and that challenging and wonderful life of raising four children and that. We were United Methodists. Actually, I go back to the time when it was just Methodist and became United Methodist while I was around seventh grade or so. But being a part of the church was an important part of our family. We were almost always there. If you grew up Methodist like I did, I had all the perfect attendance Sunday school bars that you hung on top of one another and that. That's a foreign concept now, but it was something we were quite proud of as a family and that. And my dad's normal day was up early and out in the fields or fixing a tractor or whatever, but on Sunday morning he was dressed for church in his suit and sat at our little desk and wrote a check and had a box of envelopes. And if you also were raised Methodist, you know what that box of envelopes were. And we would all go to church. Actually, we all had our own envelopes for Sunday school and that. But being there and being as a family, worshiping together and supporting that church was an important part. And I didn't know that growing up. It's when reflecting on it, why I give now. I was taught stewardship by watching my dad write that check every Sunday. I said we were almost always there. There were many times I was like, can we just skip a Sunday? Do we have to be there? And that, and it's like, no, we were there. I think it must have been a winter day. We were all dressed for church, which I'm still amazed. You know, these were simple times. Six of us in an old farmhouse with one bathroom, everybody ready and good to go. And when we came back from church, there was a dinner all ready to be served too. So I don't know how my mother accomplished all that. But one Sunday, the car didn't start. And rather than give up, which would have been the easy thing to do, the six of us piled in our pickup truck in the cab, and we went to church. And that's the part Lamar really liked. So we fast forward. I learned stewardship that way. And you know, why do we give now? Although we weren't members of this congregation when my children were growing up, Paul and I have two boys. Being a part of children's ministry and youth ministry, the mission trips and all that, were an important part of our family. And we gave then and we give now, so other families have that opportunity. That's an important part of that. We weren't always able to give that 10% level, but the tithe is important to us and we give at that level now. And I encourage others to do that. We have so many dynamic ministries, and we have a creative and dedicated staff that are all doing wonderful work for this church. I hope you participate along with that. Last year, just around a third of our congregation made a commitment to the church by completing a pledge card, a commitment card. Unfortunately, that's the national trends. I don't agree with it. I hope that this year, that this congregation can buck those trends and that. I invite you to participate in the dynamic ministries that are going on here. Next Sunday is our Commitment Sunday. You'll have a chance to bring a card to the communion rail when you come for communion. If you're not available next Sunday, maybe your car won't start. I hope it does, but you never know. If you're not here next Sunday, please make a commitment. Our ministries and the missions and that of this church are so valuable to what's going on in our congregation and our community. In our main hall, there's a series of posters that talk about the theme, "This is why I give." I had the privilege of having lunch with a young couple a few weeks ago, and they shared they love this church, and this is their church, and that's why they give. And I hope you have that strong commitment too. I know once you make that commitment, and I hope you do for next year, that you won't regret it. There's so many good things going on. I know you want to be a part of that. Thank you.
You have to respect people who will applaud for the pickup truck. The spirit of Roger's message is a perfect way for us to lead in to this time of sharing and giving. And so I would like to invite our ushers to come forward now for the presentation of our tithes and offerings.
As we bring our gifts before you, we give thanks to you, O God, for your mercy and your love and for your grace. All our gifts are but a token of the things we owe to you. Please accept our humble offering, we pray.
With clear minds and open hearts, we enthusiastically offer these gifts to you, O God, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Long ago, a man did travel from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among a band of robbers, left him for dead beside the road. The only soul who had compassion was a stranger to God's chosen race, was one who had the heart of Jesus and saved this man from a wretched fate. One man sought to help his neighbor in his suffering and pain. Now I hear the words of our dear Savior saying, "Go and do the same." Thank you.
descend and come among us, O Lord, we pray. Please fill our hearts with gladness this holy day. We pray that you will listen our words to hear and quiet now our spirits to us come near.
Oh, good and gracious God, there are so many things for us to be grateful for today. We are grateful for the ways that you transform us from being people who are frantic doers to people who truly want to connect with you and with one another. We are grateful for the majesty of your artwork, for the glorious sunrise of this day, for the reds and the golds that you used on the canvas. And now for the ways that that sunrise continues within each of us. We thank you for this specific day, a day that for some is a birthday, for others it's an anniversary. For some, that anniversary may be of a wedding. For others, that anniversary may be of the death of a loved one. You are present with each one of us, regardless of what the significance of today is, and we thank you for that. As we focus on one another and as we sit near one another, our minds and our hearts go to our sisters and our brothers throughout the entire eastern part of the United States and throughout the world. May we be people of compassion. And may we be connected to one another in the name of Jesus, who teaches us to pray together as we now say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Descend and come among us.
Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning, it comes from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 19 through 24, if you'd like to follow along. So Jesus continued, "Stop collecting treasures for your own benefit on earth, where moth and rust eat them, and where thieves break in and steal them. Instead, collect treasures for yourself in heaven, where moth and rust don't eat them, and where thieves don't break in and steal them. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. Therefore, if your eye is healthy, then your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, then your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how terrible that darkness will be. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be loyal to the one and have contempt for the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. God speaks to us through the reading of Scripture.
So good to see you all this morning and to be together in worship. And I add my welcome to you, especially on behalf of the whole church. If you're guests with us, we welcome you and are glad you're worshiping with us today. We're in a series called The United Methodist Way. As you know, if you've been here for the first few parts of the series, you know that this coming May is General Conference. It happens every 4 years, the General Conference of the United Methodist Denomination. This past week, I was in Portland, where the General Conference will be held. It was a gathering, lasted a couple of days, of those who are heads of the delegations from the various annual conferences, gathered for what's called the pre-General Conference briefing. That also happens every 4 years in January before the conference happens, to discuss, to talk about what the main issues are that will be coming up, and to have a look at the convention center, and to orient ourselves and to prepare for the work that will be ours in May. And one of the themes that came up over and over again was that we share so much in common. That as United Methodists, we are Wesleyan Christians, and that means that we as United Methodists have certain things that we emphasize and ways of being together, and things that we do that we think are important as United Methodists. Those were the things that we emphasized. What is it that unites us and brings us together? And I hope to do the same in today and next week as we complete that sermon, but I hope that I've done some of that in the course of this sermon series. Today I want to talk about the United Methodist Way is a way of giving, and maybe a better way to put that is a way of stewardship. That is, a way of being stewards, caretakers of all that God has entrusted to us for the time that we are here. How are we as stewards. What is our way of giving and of managing that which God has entrusted to us? Our theme for this stewardship campaign, as you know, every year we have a time when we emphasize stewardship, is why I give. This is why I give. That's the theme. Last year the theme was, this is why we give. There's a subtle difference there, but the difference is important. It's a difference intended to focus each one of us on the question that pertains to each one of us. Why do I give? Why is giving important for me? Why is giving important in my life? That's the question for each one of us. We talk often about what our money accomplishes. As you know, it takes money to be in ministry as a church. And that money covers all sorts of ministries locally and throughout our community and throughout the globe, makes all of that possible. We talk about that a lot. We've emphasized that a lot in our stewardship campaigns. But today I want to emphasize something different, and that is what giving means to each one of us, what it means in our lives. And not just giving, but what the place of money and possessions means in our lives. Some people say that we talk about money too much. Well, I don't think we talk about it enough, really. I mean, you look at the words of Jesus. He had 38 parables that he told. 16 of them had to do with how we handle this issue of money and possessions in our lives, the role that it has, and what our possessions can accomplish through us, but also what they can do to us and in us as well. It's an important spiritual issue. And not just in the teachings of Jesus, but throughout the Bible. 2,000 verses or so have to do with this issue of how we handle stuff and possessions in our own lives and the role of giving. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, had three simple principles for giving. And he said that they are these. We should earn all we can. We should save all we can. And we should give all we can. Simple. Earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. He had some qualifications. In your earning, be sure that as you earn all you can, you don't harm yourself. That is, that you make sure that earning all you can doesn't overtake your life, that it doesn't harm other people, that it doesn't harm relationships, that it doesn't harm what you do to make money doesn't harm others. But he said, with those qualifications, earn all you can. Work hard. Do good things and earn all you can. The second thing he said was save all you can. And by that, Wesley did not mean simply saving up a nest egg, saving for the future, saving for retirement. He meant within your own life, within your own thinking and the way you live your life, figure out where is the line between enough and excess. What does it take for you to have a fulfilled and fulfilling life and to provide for your family and to do the things that contribute to your family and community? Provide the basic necessities. What's the difference between that and excess? Excess that can overtake your life, it can lessen community, it can become the one in the driver's seat. Where is that line? That's a difficult one. And so when Wesley said, save all you can, he was getting at that issue of how much is enough. There was a conference on alternative economics, and after one of the sessions, a group of people gathered for dinner, and around the dinner conversation, this issue came up. One person in the group had shared that he spent several summers at a monastery, a week out of the summer, that is, at a monastery in a very small room, a bed, a table, a lamp, and a chair. That's it in the room. Just thinking and meditating and praying and journaling and walking the grounds of the monastery. Food was provided by the monks there, a silent order of monks, so it was a very quiet retreat. He said the last time he did it, which was not long before this conversation, he said that it occurred to him to ask the question, what if this is all I had? A chair, a table, a lamp, and a bed. Would it be enough? And that sparked this conversation. What's enough? Well, you would need some means to make a living. I mean, the monks aren't going to be there. You don't live in a monastery. None of us do. You've got to make a living. So somebody has to put food on the table. And so that requires tools, whether that's a computer or farming implements or whatever the tools might be. You've got to have tools. You've got to have something to work with. You have to have some paperwork. Everybody has to have that, whether you like it or not. And so there would be files. And someone else said, well, you've got to have a phone. And you need at least one more chair. You don't want to be by yourself. You want to have company. And if you've got a family, you need more furniture than that. And on the conversation went. And one of the participants reported that the longer the conversation went on, the more difficult it became to find that line between enough and excess. And they never did find the line, of course. It's too fuzzy. Got fuzzier and fuzzier as time went on. They couldn't do it in one conversation. I certainly can't do it in a sermon. And I can't do it for you, and you can't do it for me. Each of us has to find where is that place in our lives. And what does it mean to save all we can through a kind of simplicity of living and careful planning? And then finally, Wesley said, give all you can. And it's that one we're focusing on, really. It's give all you can. Jesus had a lot to say about this, as I mentioned earlier. And in our passage for today, he tells us, first of all, that giving is a way of investing in that which is durable. It lasts. Giving is investing ourselves, our time, our talents, our abilities, what influence and power we have, and our money in that which lasts. It's durable. We all know the importance of durability. We talk about it all the time. We want a car that's durable. We want anything we buy to be durable. We want our relationships, our friendships to be durable. Even a child knows, a very young child understands very early the importance of durability. One father learned this when his little 3.5, 4-year-old daughter said to him as he was going out the door to run an errand, Daddy, bring me back something. What do you want me to bring you? He asked. And she replied, something that will last forever. Because she knew toys break, batteries run down. Some of those toys that she had, they didn't hold much interest for her anymore. Nothing seemed to last. Bring me back something that will last forever. And what Jesus is saying when he says, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust can eat them and where thieves can break in and steal them, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust can eat them and where thieves cannot break in and steal them. They endure. They last. What is it that lasts? What is it that lasts is what we invest in people, how we give ourselves in ministry to others, the difference we make in the lives of other people through our giving and through our time and through our service and through our commitments and all that we have and all that we are. That's what lasts. That's what endures. You know, I love to read epitaphs because epitaphs are ways that the departed want to express something that people will read over and over again and know something about that person. Some of them are humorous. Some of them are very serious. One that I particularly appreciate, he asked that these words be inscribed on his tombstone. What I spent, I lost. What I saved, I left. What I gave, I have. What was he saying? He was saying that what he gave was durable. It lasted, far outlived him, because he invested in the lives of people. He invested himself in others. He made a difference in his world through his giving. So Jesus called us to invest in that which lasts, that which is durable. He also warned his followers, warns us, that money is a very good servant, but it's a terrible master. And he said in this section of the Sermon on the Mount, no one can serve two masters. You will love the one and hate the other, be devoted to one, despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth, he said. And it's because the place of God in our lives can never be replaced with money. In fact, when we put it in that place, it's disastrous. Money becomes our master, and it is a terrible taskmaster, but it is a great servant. Money is a great servant. It can accomplish great good. And so Jesus is warning us to make sure we know, is money in the driver's seat or is God in the driver's seat? After whom do I order my life? And who am I following? It is a very personal question. Why I give is a personal question that has great consequences beyond our own person. And Jesus points us in that direction. This is why I give, because Christ has called me to give in that way, to invest in that which is eternal, and to give of myself in a way that endures. This is why we give. You know, Jesus said, we lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven and not on earth. And why do we do that? Because where your treasure is, your heart will follow. That's where your heart will be. Why do we give? We give because we know that where we give, our heart follows that place. Now, we know it works the other way, too, that we give to where our heart is. My heart is with my children, and so I want to give to provide for my children. My heart is with my grandchildren. I want to give to my grandchildren. My heart is with my dogs, and so we spend a lot on our dogs because I love them. I care for them. My heart is in a lot of places, and so I give to those places. But it works the other way, too, and that's what Jesus was saying. He was saying that where our treasure goes, our heart follows. And that to give intentionally in the places where God would have us go, and to give intentionally in ways that extend the ministry of Christ, is to go ahead of our hearts, and our hearts will follow in those places, and our spiritual lives will be uplifted. Because where your treasure is, there is your heart also. Susan and I have a physical trainer. We have a physical trainer that works with us at the gym 3 days a week. We leave the house. We get up at 5 a.m. to go and do this. Why do we pay this person? Because we would not get up at 5 a.m. and go do that. Because where our treasure is, there will our heart be also. And if we wake up in the morning and our heart is just not in it, our treasure's over there. And so we go. And our heart drags us there. And we're glad we went. Now, that's a silly illustration, but that's the way it works. Our heart follows our treasure. I give because I want my heart to be in the right places, to be devoted to the right things. I give because I want my heart to go where God is at work. That's why I give. And that's what Jesus called us to do and who Jesus called us to be. So I want to close with a couple of things. One is John Wesley's sermon on the use of money, where Wesley makes this distinction between money as a servant, money as a master, and how much money can accomplish for good. He said this, he said, "Money is an excellent gift of God, answering the noblest ends. In the hands of his children, it is food for the hungry and drink for the thirsty. It's clothing for the naked. It gives to the traveler and the stranger where to lay his head. By it, we may supply the place of a husband to the widow and of a father to the fatherless. We may be a defense for the oppressed, a means of health to the sick, of ease to them that are in pain. It may be as eyes to the blind and as feet to the lame, yea, a lifter up from the gates of death." That's what money can do when money is a servant, Wesley said. The other thing I want to share is from Stephen King. I don't quote Stephen King very often. Stephen King, the very successful author of horror stories, horror novels, who also, if you read his novels carefully, I've read a bunch of them, you will begin to notice that there are themes in there about goodness. There are themes in there that really are very consistent with the Christian faith, and in interviews he has said as much. In 2001, he gave the commencement address at Vassar College, and I want to read a portion of what he said to that group. It's a little bit lengthy, but it's so good. He acknowledged in that speech that he had had a terrible accident 2 years earlier in which he was almost killed. You may remember that. He was walking along the road and a minivan hit him and severely injured him. And he talked about that, but he also talked about the earning potential of the graduates that were sitting before him. And here's what he said. "Well, I'll tell you one thing you're not going to do, and that's take it with you. I'm worth I don't know exactly how many millions of dollars, and a couple of years ago I found out what 'you can't take it with you' means. I found out while I was lying in the ditch at the side of a country road covered with mud and blood and with the tibia of my right leg poking out through the side of my jeans. I had a MasterCard in my wallet, but when you're lying in the ditch with broken glass in your hair, no one accepts MasterCard. We all know that life is ephemeral, but on that particular day and in the months that followed, I got a painful but extremely valuable look at life's simple backstage truths. We come in naked and broke. We may be dressed when we go out, but we're just as broke. And how long in between? Just the blink of an eye." King went on to discuss what the graduates could do with their earnings in the time that they had in that eye blink. And then he said this, "For a short period, you and your contemporaries will wield enormous power, the power of the economy, the power of the hugest military industrial complex in the history of the world, the power of the American society that you will create in your own image. It's your time, your moment, don't miss it." And then he added, "Of all the power which will shortly come into your hands, the greatest is undoubtedly the power of compassion, the ability to give. We have enormous resources in this country, resources you yourselves will soon command, but they are only yours on loan. I came here to talk about charity, and I want you to think about it on a large scale. Should you give away what you have? Of course you should. I want you to consider making your lives one long gift to others. And why not? All you want to get at the getting place, none of that is real. All that lasts is what you pass on. And the rest is smoke and mirrors." And then he ended with this. "Giving isn't about the receiver or the gift but the giver. It's for the giver. One doesn't open one's wallet to improve the world, although it's nice when that happens. One does it to improve oneself. I give because it's the only concrete way I have of saying that I'm glad to be alive and that I can earn my daily bread doing what I love. Giving is a way of taking the focus off the money we make and putting it back where it belongs, on the lives we lead, the families we raise, the communities which nurture us. I wonder if some folks there who heard that thought, that's the scariest thing Stephen King ever wrote. Perhaps the most profound, and very much in sync with what it means to be a giver. It's my prayer for you and for me that we will go from this place and we'll think about, where is that line for me in my life? That we'll go from this place and we'll think about, why do I give and what difference does it make, not only in the world, not only in the community or the church, but in my life? And what does it mean for me to be a giver? Amen.
If today's the day that you would like to give your life to Christ and begin that journey with membership in this congregation, then I would invite you to come forward as we stand and sing hymn number 504. We will sing the first and second verses.
To you, Brian Sherrup. He's a United Methodist and he transfers from another Methodist church locally, moving up in the world. And we're delighted to have him come this morning and be a part of us.
We are delighted, Brian. And as you become a part of this community of faith, I ask you, do you reaffirm your faith in Christ?
I do.
And will you be loyal to the church and uphold it by your prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness?
I will.
Welcome again to you. I'm going to ask Brian to remain up front after the close of the service to give you an opportunity to come by and give him a warm First Church welcome. Our gathering will soon be ended. Where will we go and what will we do? May grace, peace, hope, love, and joy forever accompany you. Amen.
One, two, three, four.
with Peter on the sea. Hug your nets and follow me. We are almost now to the shore. Fight on, fight on, children, don't turn back. We are almost now to the shore. I said fight on, fight on, children, don't turn back. We are almost. On the mountaintop, he said, keep on going and don't you stop. We are almost down the shore. Fight on, fight on, over and on, turn back. We are almost down the shore.